Are we ready to get started? Everybody have a seat. Well, good evening and welcome. On behalf of the Seminole Historical Society, I'd like to welcome you to our beginning of our second year of activities and events in the museum. I'm Michelle Abramo, the president, and at this time, if you don't mind standing up, I'm going to stand with the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. Be seated. Before we get into our program, I'd like to make a couple introductions. Of course, our board of directors and those that are here, if you would just please stand and stay standing. Nancy Barlow, Sue Etter, Gloria Douglas, Sandy Holloway, Celeste Horn, Eva Jones, Barbara Coyotes, Lou LeGrand, Marilyn Mone, and Jimmy Vines. Thank you. And then from our great city of Sutton, our city manager, Ann Tony Deal. Mayor Leslie Waters. And if the counselors will stand also, Tom Bornhorn, Chris Burke, Roger Edelman, Bob Matthews, Jim Quinn, and Trish Springer. Thank you for being here. And I have to say, thank you very, very much for being here. This is the first time all the city councilors have been in the museum, so we're tickled about that. I do have some basic things that I need to cover. There are some sign-up sheets that are floating around here. Please make sure that you sign up for something. There's different ways that you can help the museum by having treats in the evening for our events. After that, sharing those. Especially being a docent or a guide in the museum, we have about 9 to 11 people trained besides the board that are here on either Friday evenings for Music in the Park or Saturdays from 10 to 2. We are hoping that we get all of them up and running, but we certainly need more. We'd love to be open another day during the week besides just the Saturday, so don't feel intimidated by it. Jimmy Vines is going to train you, our historian. You don't need to know everything that he knows. It's no way possible. But as the board has always said, you know, we all know something different. We all have our own little stories. So that's what we're hoping that you as a guide will do, is learn something, a little bit of everything. We do have a cheat sheet notebook in the back. So if somebody says, oh, tell me about the World War II Memorial and you don't know about it, you can run to that. And you're not here by yourself. There's a minimum of 2, usually 3 or 4 people that are here on Friday night and on Saturdays. Lou LeGrand in the back, who is just waving the calendar, he's the gentleman that is organizing our guides, our docents, so certainly please see him after this evening or sign up. I believe there's a sign up going around for that. We are also looking for someone to take care of our advertising needs. We need someone who can put out our press releases and other ways to get the word out about us and encourage more people to be here at our meetings and our events. If you are interested in that, please come see me. It's not only press releases in the Beacon. We do have a website. We do want to make connections with all of the museums in Pinellas County and in Hillsborough. We've been talking about this for about a year now, and would like to see this come to fruition. So if you've just got a little bit of time and you like being on the phone to reaching out to those museums or also to our local publications, certainly come see me, because we could use another hand in that. In our gift shop, there are plenty of items for you to purchase. We've got pencils, we've got Seminole six stickers, we have t-shirts that are on sale, we have cookbooks, Campbell cookbooks. We also have the Seminole book that Jim Schnur, our local author, has penned. And actually, if you do buy one of those books and you would like it to be autographed, just let us know. You can leave it here or bring it back. I can make sure that we get Jim here and sign it, or I can take it to one of the meetings that he and I meet at once a month, also for the library. So so certainly, we'd love you for you to purchase one of those items. There is also, and this is brand new, this is our sponsorship flyer. It's a beautiful piece that Etter Ventures has put together for us, Sue and Jeff Etter, and they help us out on the board. And that is an opportunity to sponsor one of our displays here. It is for a particular time, 3 to 5 years. It's not a lot of money. It starts at $1,000. And you can have your name on it, and you'll be posted next to that display. So if you're interested in doing that for family, for a group, for businesses, please take a look at this. Please see any one of the board members. We would love to be able to talk to you about that. It's something that we see happening at Clearwater Public Library. We see it at the other museums, and we would love to see that happen here too. And those monies, even though these displays are done, those monies go to helping other displays, but your name is on the one that you choose to be on. So please, please come see that form and come talk to one of us. While I'm directing you over here, this beautiful piece, this past end of the spring, summer, I work at Bowder Elementary, and somebody came up to me there at school and said, "Oh my gosh, there's a gentleman in my neighborhood who's selling some cabinets. You need to go over there. I think they're free." So, of course, then somebody else came in who is a member, and I said, "You know, I can't leave here from school, but could you drive by that house and see?" So he drove by, then he's calling me on the cell phone, then we're calling another board member, and it turns out that it is at Pat and Gary Hughes' house, and the cabinets are around the corner, and those were a great find. Those cabinets are going to be something that we'd like to use for display, for rotating display. If you have... What our interest in these is, if you have a collection that you would like to show off and only loan to the museum so that people can see whatever kind of collection you have, salt and pepper shakers from the 1930s, 1940s, I don't know, you know, war memorials, things like that. A club or an organization says, "Hey, we'd like to get a little bit more activity, you know, people seeing about us." That's what these cabinets are going to be for. It's going to be of no cost to you. The only thing that we probably might want you to do is print a couple things just to talk about it. But then you'll only loan it to us for maybe 3 or 4 months. And it gets people back into the museum. There's the idea of the press release. Gets people back in the museum to say, "Hey, we've got this neat little thing that you can see that somebody has loaned." And then we'll be happy to give it back to you and do another display. So think about what you have. You're collecting something. Your wife or your husband says, "Hey, I want that out of the wherever," and you can give it to us for a short period of time. We'll package it up and send it back, and they won't even know it's the same thing. Along with that, though, in their garage, Pat and Gary Hughes, they had this item. Now imagine this. It was not like this. It was in over 80 pieces, and it sat on the floor about this high. Piles of wood and glass and shelving. And he said, "What about this? This would be really great at the museum." And I said, "There's no way. There's no way we're bringing that in." And I had two other gentlemen with me who are carpenters and helpers. And they're like, "No, Michelle, I don't think there's any plan, any hope for that." And Sue, God bless her, she just kept saying, "You know, this is, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. We're going to be able to do it. We're going to do it." And I'm like, no. And yeah, we're going to take it. And Gary's going, "Yeah, you really need to take it. I'll help you. As he's selling his home and he's moving away. Although I think it was only down the island, Treasure Island or something like that. So we piled it into the back of a truck. We brought it in. And the very next time that we had a board meeting, I said to Sue and I said to everybody else, mark today's date. 2 weeks. Sue's got 2 weeks. It was sitting back here by the garage door, and I said, in 2 weeks, if it's not taken care of, we're getting rid of it. Because we've made such progress in making this place look beautiful, and I just can't have this in the back collecting bugs or whatever that all this wood is just going to be sitting there with. Well, it took a little bit longer than 2 weeks, but on a Saturday or a Sunday, Sue and Jeff and Gary came out here, and they put this together. And it is stunning. So thank you to them. Thank you to the Etters. The company that made this, Jeff Etter, sent a video and a letter to them to tell them that we had had this recreated. You know, maybe they might want to say, "Oh, that's pretty cool, and we really like it. It's in your library." Maybe they'll make a donation or something. But it has new glass in it. We had glass donated by a company called...
Glass Pros
came out and put the glass in for us. And it's a beautiful, beautiful piece. And it represents the city of Seminole. And this is our Seminole timeline. So a very nice piece. Thank you to the Hughes family for your donations. All right, coming up, thanks to our chairperson, Eve Jones. Eve, give away. He's been working really hard with this, along with the Chick-fil-A family, and that is Sandy and Gary
Malnowski.
Okay, I only know them as Sandy and Gary, but anyway, they're the owners of Chick-fil-A on Park Boulevard. They're very generous. They do a lot of sponsorships and a lot of programs and a lot of fundraisers in the community. I know we have one at school for us. They do them for all kinds of groups. But they and Eve have put together a fundraiser for us for the museum. 15% of your receipt is going to come back to the museum, and that's what those coupons are on your chairs. Now, we ask that you take those if you're going to use them. If not, that's okay, because if you don't take it with you, we're going to be there also. And we're allowed, the Chick-fil-A family is allowing us to stand outside the door tomorrow night and hand those out as you come through or you go through the drive-thru. Obviously, we'd love for you to come inside, sit, and have fellowship with us. We're going to be, Mayor Waters and I are going to be greeters. We're going to be, maybe not mayor, but I probably will be cleaning floors, tidying up chairs and tables, bringing your food to you, many things. All the things that go on in a Chick-fil-A in a restaurant. And then we're going to also be doing some little fundraisers where you do Wheel of Fortune and little goodies like that. But that evening, and it starts at 5,
Five to eight.
We'll be there a little bit earlier, and oh my gosh, there's a couple ladies here this evening that actually thought it was this evening. They went and with their coupon, and Chick-fil-A took it. So we've already kicked off our fundraiser. So thank you, ladies, for doing that. But certainly, if you don't bring your coupon, we're going to have them there. And we're expecting a great turnout from this community. And everybody out there that's not here this evening. So we're looking forward to it, and we hope that we see you there tomorrow evening. And just so you know, if you can't dine with us, you can go through the drive-thru. And one of our board members did find out through Eve that this is a great time to buy holiday gift cards, and they're accepting those as a donation also. If you want to do that, that's going to be part of the 15% of that receipt. They'll go towards come to the museum if you want to buy gift cards for holiday stockings or whatever the case may be. Thanksgiving, they're not open on Thanksgiving, but you know, it could be a gift card for the day after if you're tired of turkey. Anyway, all right, so we hope to see you tomorrow night. And next, on with the show, I'd like to welcome Sandy Holloway, who will introduce our guest for this evening. Sandy.
Thank you very much, Michelle. I think it'd be a nice time to just give a nice round of applause to Michelle Abramo. Yes. Making this all come together, and believe me, this is a wonderful facility, and we're so thankful to the city and all that have been involved. But Michelle and her great group of the board members have done, I think, a really spectacular job of bringing it together with wonderful, wonderful past and present of Seminole. And I think we should all be very, very proud of that. So thank you, Michelle. Okay. I may not give up the podium after this, Michelle. It's with extreme pleasure that I introduce to you this evening three gentlemen instrumental in the formation of our city of Seminole: Dr. Ed Lurie, Nevis Herrington, and Dennis DeLoach. All right, Dennis, yes. These men were members of the Greater Seminole Area Chamber of Commerce and part of the committee that spearheaded this initiative for us to form a city some 46 years ago. Dr. Ed Lurie, at the time, was president of the chamber, a practicing physician, and major developer in our area. Today, we have him to thank for a most generous donation that he has made to the city for a building to house the Seminole Chamber on the soon-to-be-developed waterfront park. He also had the honor of serving as Mr. Seminole in what year, Ed? Oh, you don't. I had a bet here. I asked Dennis if he knew what year he was Mr. Seminole. He said, well, I'm sure that Ed will know what year he was. But and when? 1979. Very good. Okay, and Dennis is back there still thinking. Okay, so in 1979, he was our Mr. Seminole. Nevis Herrington, at that time, was an educator and instructor at St. Petersburg Junior College in political science and education, and he served as the parliamentarian for the committee. In 1978, he became vice president of St. Pete Junior College, where he remained until his retirement in 1997. As an aside, he was hired some years before that, sight unseen, as an instructor for St. Pete High School. And the reason was is they just really loved his voice and spoke very well. So, you know, an instructor, an educator, a good voice means a lot, doesn't it? So, anyway, Dennis DeLoach served as the attorney for the committee and at that time practiced law with the Fisher and Sauls firm. In 1976, he formed his own firm, which is currently DeLoach and Hofstra, PA, on Seminole Boulevard, which we all pass at least once a day, or maybe more. And I might note that DeLoach and Hofstra are... They are sponsors for this week for the Sounds of Soul that are performing at Music in the Park, celebrating our 20th anniversary. So it's a really great event, and we're very thankful that you all were sponsors for that. It means a lot. And Dennis was Mr. Seminole sometime. Okay. So I'd like to conclude this with Ed and wife Vivian, Nevis and his wife Kate, and Dennis and wife Faye all continue to reside in Seminole, certainly a testimonial to the wonderful, vibrant city that they helped to create. So please give a very warm welcome to these three gentlemen as we go down memory lane. Thank you.
Selected to be the first speaker because I've been here the longest. In 1956, in July of 1956, I had just completed my medical internship in Cleveland, Ohio, and I had a prearranged locum tenens. That's a temporary fill-in for a doctor that was going away on vacation in St. Petersburg. And while there, I took a liking to what I felt in this was happening in this area. General Electric and Minneapolis Honeywell were newly arrived then, and the type of progress that was being made in the county, throughout the county, appealed to me. And there was an ad in the St. Petersburg Times for a building that was being built in Seminole that could be customized for different uses. And I spoke to the man that owned this building, was developing this building, and he agreed to rent me 1,100 square foot office and customized it for my medical use. While there, this gave me a headquarters. While there, I established my own practice, and the longer I remained here in Seminole, the better I liked it. Madeira Beach was uptown. We didn't even have a grocery store. Hollister Hardware was a big thing to do. There were packing houses for grapefruit. Pinellas County and Seminole is noted for flat bottom grapefruit. I wonder how many people really realize that. These flat bottom grapefruit packed more nicely in the containers for shipping up north. While here, after a while, the Chamber of Commerce was organized and I became a member. And in 1970, the city of St. Petersburg, city of Madeira Beach, the city of Largo, the city of Pinellas Park were all anxious to annex more territory to become parts of those cities, and we were kind of fearful that this would happen. The government that we had were homeowners associations in the various subdivisions. The Pinellas County government, homeowners associations would attend county commission meetings to assert what they thought they ought to have and get from the county commission. And the Chamber of Commerce was very much aware of what was happening and wanted to keep the Seminole identity. And a secret committee was formed because we were fearful that if these other cities became aware of what was happening, they might take steps to not let it happen. And this committee was formed, and the Bank of Seminole and various members of the committee donated enough money to hire someone to help organize our effort to incorporate Seminole into a city. And Dennis, I'm going to hand the microphone to Nevis first, and he will tell you when he got here and what his function was.
Thank you, Ed. In 1965, my family was growing, and we needed a bigger house. So I sent my wife out this way to look for some property and a house. And she did come back, but anyway, she came back with some information about where we could get some land. The land was located right down the street here, Old Curse Road, 125th Street.
125th
Street. 120th Street. I stand corrected. It was 128th Street, right. And it was 3 acres. And the realtor we were using said, well, if you don't want all of it, I'll take half of it. So she took half of it, Ruth Rushing. She took half of it, and I took half of it, and I built the house there in 1970. But anyway, that's how we came out here. The family was growing, and we needed more room. And I built a hotel. That's what they call it anyway. But then we got into a situation where I guess the city or something needed a parliamentarian for the city of Seminole to incorporate. So someone called the college and asked for a parliamentarian. and I was the only Bob and Jerry. And they needed somebody who knew the rules of order and so forth. But anyway, I was asked to become the parliamentarian for the City of Seminole Incorporation on November the 15th, 1970. And the vote was taken, and it was passed, everything was clean, and was submitted to the state for ratification. So we were on our way. Thanks to Ed and Richard, we really appreciate it.
Hear me without this?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you. First of all, it's good to be here. This facility right here is here because of the creation of the city. And the city has done so much for this area. And we're glad here to talk to you about the history. And looking in the back, see Marilyn Mooney, she was there when the city was formed. And I don't know if there were any other people present, anyone, others here tonight who were present at that meeting. Anyone else? But anyway, Ed was, I started practicing law here in 64 with Fisher Sauls, and I joined the Seminole Kiwanis Club, and that was a fortuitous thing for me because there's some really good people in that club who were instrumental in forming the city. One was Jesse Johnson, who was really the probably father of Seminole. He was the Seminole Bank, Seminole Nursery, gave land for the Boy Scouts, and just a real leader, really civic-minded person, just wanted to create an identity here. And we had the Seminole Post Office and the Seminole Fire Department. And as Ed said, there was a feeling that we need to do something to have a city so we can have an identity. And Charlie Block came to work for the bank. And Charlie knew that Mr. Jesse had the idea of having a city. It was just a goal of his. And it's my understanding that the two other attempts were tried that failed. And so when Ed says it was in secret, it was. It was something that it wasn't a popular subject, or you talk to somebody, you wouldn't know whether or not it was people in favor of it or not. So Charlie became kind of the, let's do this. He was a ringleader, Ed was. And then we formed this committee called the Christmas Tree Committee, and I was a member of that. That was a code name. And we went to the law offices of Fisher Sauls to find out what we could do to form a city. And most cities, in fact all cities except this city, is created by the legislature. A special act creates and makes a municipal corporation. So that's what this city is. Any city is a municipal corporation. And so, but the legislature did provide a way for cities, for groups of people, citizens, to form without the legislature. Now, there's been no way that with the number of cities in this county that the legislators would have agreed to form another city. They say that's the last thing we need in this county is another city. But here's what the statute says. It is lawful for the male and female inhabitants who are freeholders and registered voters of any hamlet, village, or town in this state, not less than 1,000 in number, who shall have the qualifications hereunder as prescribed to establish for themselves municipal government. And then the most important section is 165.04, proceedings of meeting. At the time and place designated in the notice aforesaid, the male and female inhabitants who are freeholders and registered voters present, being not less than 2/3 of those whom it is proposed to incorporate, shall select a corporate name and seal for the municipality which they propose to form and designate by definite meets and bounds the territorial limits thereof. They shall then proceed to choose by vote of a majority the not more than nine aldermen. So that's the procedure. So you've got to have more than 1,000. You've got to get them present at a meeting to vote on. Okay, how do you do that? Well, Charlie came up with the idea, and the Seminole Improvement Committee was formed, and money was raised. The bank gave $5,000. I think Dr. Ed gave $500. Fisher Sauls gave $500. And other people made contributions. I remember seeing the list with Ed Weideman and Ed Grayson on the list. But come up with a sum of money to hire someone to help. And so Charlie put an ad in the paper, and a fellow, Glenn Van Trees, was hired. Glenn had worked for a city up north and was a good administrative person, and then set up an office, and I believe the office was in the office of the chamber at that time, and got the information of who would be in the core. Well, the core had to be where the shopping centers were, because that's where the cigarette tax was going to come. So it had to be around Seminole Mall and the Grant Shopping Center. And so they got the records from the tax office as to who are the registered voters and who are the freeholders, and they went door to door to canvass to see who wanted to be in the city. We didn't want to have a situation where you'd have a bunch of people come and not going to invite people to come unless they were really interested in it. So now this is right here. This was in my office, and this was the shape. So the shape of the city initially, and so this was gerrymandering 101. And a legal description had to be obtained of this area and a notice put in the newspaper for the meeting to be held at Seminole Mall. And that meeting was held at 5 o'clock, and a total of over 800 people came. 839, I think, was the total number of people who came. And the people were checked in, they were given a ballot, and then it would by secret ballot. So the total number that was needed was 813 out of the 1,219 people had to be present and vote in favor of it. And the actual vote was 823, so by 10 votes. So at this time, the initial city council was formed, was elected, and Jesse Johnson was named the honorary mayor of the city. Bruce Stewart was elected the mayor, and then what we had to do was we went back and prepared a certificate of what had happened, where the seal was adopted, the boundary description was adopted, the name, who the people were, when it occurred, what the vote was, prepared a certificate, got it ready, and then we had to have these council people sworn in within 3 days. So we had this meeting on Sunday, and Tuesday night at the Osceola Room, we had another meeting where all the councilmen and the mayor was there. And Alan Anderson, a judge, Alan had practiced law with Fisher Sauls in Seminole when the office was first opened here. And he knew Russ Stewart really well. But he swore in Russ Stewart, and then the procedure said that Russ swears in the other people. And so that was done. Bob Ray was appointed the city clerk. And this paper was signed. Everyone signed it. We sent it to the Secretary of State. They accepted it and sent it back. And then they accepted it on the 19th of November. And then we had the first city council meeting on the 24th. So here we are, we have a meeting on November, on Sunday, and the first council meeting on the 24th of November. And a city was formed. We've got these fine representatives here now that they're just appreciate you folks coming. But it was just a tribute to people being proud of their community and willing to work hard for a purpose. And could you anywhere get 800 people out of a 1,200 to come today on a Sunday afternoon? So, but it's just the spirit of this community. We had our first city council meeting, and I've got the minutes here. Thank you, Mayor. And you've heard of a dog trying to catch a car. If you ever catch it, what are you going to do with it? That's the way we were. I mean, none of us have had any experience with the city. None of us have done any legal work for the city. So we were just crawling along. But we crawled along. We had the Bill Dunlap and I were the city attorneys, and we did a lot of work for free. We finally were paying $100 a month. But the first ordinance, let me just go over these three ordinances that were passed the first night. The one, we provided temporary rules of procedure as to how we would conduct business. Number two, an ordinance was passed prohibiting ad valorem and utility taxes unless approved by the majority of the registered electorate. And that was done because people said, "Are you folks going to raise taxes?" one of the statements were, "We're not going to have ad valorem taxes." And the next one was a tax on cigarettes. So we got that cigarette tax going right at first. And that became the money coming in for the city. And later, franchise taxes were adopted for money to come in, but that's how the city got started. So it's very interesting, and it just shows so much love for this community and community spirit.
If anybody has any questions, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I was just wondering, two quick questions. What was the problem the first two times they tried to incorporate? And secondly, what was the opposition coming from Largo or St. Petersburg or?
I don't have any knowledge of that at all. Yes.
The one report that I read was that we were getting from all sides, we were getting pressure. It could be a suburb of St. Petersburg. They even put that in the paper for a few months. I mean, I know you guys know this, but we are grateful that we stood up against these people. But not only in St. Petersburg, Largo would love to have us on their tax rolls, and we got it from Ellis Park and even Madeira Beach, you know. But we stood up against it because of you guys and because of some of those that it passed on to their reward. But it was mainly that pressure, I think.
Right. Yeah.
We didn't have an address. The post office divided at 54th Avenue North. Uh-huh. North of that was Largo Post Office, uh-huh, and south of that was Madeira Beach or St. Petersburg. And the telephone system then was Peninsula Telephone, and north of, I think, Park Boulevard, it was the Clearwater Exchange, and south, and then there was an overlap and long distance to call no further than Orange Lake Village.
I went down to the library in St. Petersburg, not too long ago, and it's really hard to get in the archives down there, but they have name cards in the old-fashioned pool drawers. And so I was looking to find something else on the city, and I pulled a card that was dated, I think, close to 1970, but not right there. And what they had on the cards is what was in the paper. And they had, I saw Seminole, so I pulled the card out. It said, "Not yet, not yet a city, but they think they are."
Oh.
So that shows the spirit.
I've got to say something about Osceola. Go ahead.
Dennis, I heard you mention Osceola, the room Osceola. Is that, how did you get the name Seminole? Was that always called Seminole in the area, or did you guys come up with the name for the city?
No, Maryland, I know, I got Seminole, but the Osceola room, you know, is above Home Federal.
Yeah.
That's what
Seminole Chiefs
called
it. Don't know. So, one more question.
Jim?
Yes.
I have some students. I used to teach American Calculus only about half a mile from the Seminole Reservation.
Okay.
And I taught Osceola children who were Seminole Indians.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that I didn't know if that made any relationship.
Yeah, well, if there's a room called Osceola in the area, then the Seminole was kind of just...
SunTrust building was the building, it was Home Federal then.
Yeah.
And they had this meeting room on the second floor that the various city... homeowners associations use that to have their meetings in.
That was my second question. Cassius Peacock built the Seminole Garden Apartments. I think he started in 1960. Did he get involved with you folks? No. Okay. I didn't think so.
Well, you mentioned something about 54th Avenue. I live on 54th Avenue.
Which side?
I'm the St. Pete mailing address. I live in the county. My mail comes through Madeira Beach.
Mayor has it.
Two comments. First of all, everyone knows that Marilyn back here is the daughter of Jesse Johnson.
Yes.
So I'm sure she has a lot of memories as a young girl growing up. Of course, while your dad was so active and really helped put us on the map. But I wanted to, last time I heard the threesome here giving us an overview to the Historical Society, you reminisced about the setup that Sunday evening at the Old Mall, in the center, before it had its different wings, before the Kmart wing, before down the other one, and you brought in folding chairs. So it was quite an ordeal to set up this meeting for 800 people to show up or whatever. So I think that just visually is a pretty awesome thing to think about.
Matthews, yeah. The other comment for Seminole being there, Seminole Elementary was formed in 1915 and it already had that name, I believe. Is that correct?
I think it was there long before that. Abby Hacker was
the. I'm saying the name Seminole was part of the Seminole Elementary.
Yeah,
you're right, Seminole Elementary.
That was my wife's.
But Jesse was adamant about wanting to call the city Seminole. He was very much.
He had Seminole Nursery and Seminole.
Yeah. Well, Marilyn is saying from the time that she remembers, this has always been Seminole to her.
Anybody have a reflection on Chief Osceola, which is on our seal? He was a relentless leader of his people. Any reflection on the seal or Chief Osceola that is on seal?
I'm not aware of that. I just know that I think that the seal that was on the city is one that the chamber used because some of the initial these minutes right here reflect the seal, the first one. So this is, and I think Bob Ray put that on there because he was secretary for the chamber, but he did these minutes. And so this is the first set of minutes that I had to see on that. So.
Okay, on the seal.
Yes. Yes, sir.
We had Seminole Palo Alto course, which began in 1967. And in 1968, Chief Joe Dan Osceola was our honored guest at the powwow. And while he was here, Holland Mangum was president of the fire department at the time. I don't think I was vice president yet, but I'm coming in as vice president. He gave us a letter granting us permission to use the Seminole Indian likeness for the city seal. That's where that came from.
Do you know where that letter is?
No, I don't.
Because we have the jackets that Chief Dan Osceola's mother made.
Right.
She hand-stitched those jackets to give to the city councilors.
Yes.
And we also have the ladle that he carved that's in our fire department that's right. To the volunteer firemen commemorating our first powwow.
Well, the ladle's here now.
Yes, the ladle is in our fire. It's in our fire department.
I was there when we got that ladle, and it was really, they kind of adopted us there for a long time, the Seminole tribe did, because we were doing the pal, they loved it, and what we were doing, because it was all community spirited, and that's what they were for, so they just really liked that and everything. And by the way, that 1,000 chairs,
yeah.
I'm the one who got them all.
Can you read the inscription on there? Because I thought it's funny.
At the Seminole Volunteer Fire Department, April 19, 1969, Chief Joe Dan Osceola, Seminole Tribe of Florida, many successful powwows to come, and less fire in your district.
Less fire for the volunteer fire department was organized. And I think, it was the Lions Club that had members go around door to door asking for $5 a year to pay for the volunteer fire department. And they bought a truck that was surplus from some government agency. And that was their first piece of equipment. Mm-hmm. And Marty Mon at the funeral home answered all the emergency calls, and that's how the fire department got started.
Yes. And also, Ed, she rang a bell.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then later on, I'm not sure of the sequence, but they had a siren, too.
They got a siren later on.
Yeah. And if they had a funeral there, this was when Mon Funeral Home was that way, not this way.
Seminole Beach Memorial.
And she said that if they had a funeral, they would tell the people if the siren goes on during the service, you know, just bear with it because it's our alarm going off.
Yeah,
if
I don't know if any gentlemen, I'm sure they know, I'd like to know when and how the change was formed.
I believe it was about a year or two. Before the city was incorporated, but I think it was 50s, I think. And it was, you know, business and professional people that belonged to it, a joint, and they were pretty active. And of course, without the chamber, the city wouldn't be here.
And Russ Stewart was the first chamber president and also the first mayor. So Russ was a contributor somewhat to the city.
Any other questions?
Just, Dr. Lurie, don't tell them what they paid for that first fire truck because we just bought a new one.
There's a fire truck on display at Heritage Park or Village. I wonder if that's the one you're seeing.
No, this was
it was a brush truck.
It was a brush truck.
Yes.
Well, it was from some fire forestry service, I believe. It didn't look, it wasn't red. It didn't look like a fire truck.
We have the picture of it. It may be in the display or it's still in our archives that we put back there. But
the brush truck, the only thing left of it was the door for the very longest time, and the fire department, when we were up in their attics trying to find stuff for the museum, said, oh, it's at this particular, is it Joe's junkyard, or there's somebody's, it's in that very far from here, Largo or Pinellas Park, that was a junkyard. And they said the last thing they saw it was just the door hanging on the fence. Well, the gentleman that owned it, his children were taking over the business, and by the time we got there, it was already gone. But it was just the door left at that time.
Well, I just wanted to add something to what Nevis had said about when we bought our property in 1968 out here. Things were very, very different. Now, those of you who lived here a long time know this, but when we bought the land, it was nothing but a humongous palmetto patch, pine trees, every kind of ugly, horrible undergrowth. And that's what we bought to build a house on. And it was the south side of Old Oakhurst. There was no road, so the mortgage company said, you must put in a road before we give you a mortgage. So we put in 128th Street, just down to our property that we bought, with shell on it. Then, next thing was, there was no electricity. There was no water. So we had to run electricity from someplace off of Old Oakhurst, west of our property. They didn't charge us a whole lot, but we got electricity. And then it was water. Water was the biggie because there were no pipes down here in this area. The pipes were along what is now Park Boulevard. So we had to run water from what's now Park Boulevard down to our property. It was six blocks, and we had to pay for that. And luckily, someone was building next to us, so they were wonderful and shared it. We did. There were a few people living on 128 between Old Oakhurst and Park. And nobody, no, we don't want to tie in. We're happy with our well. We're happy with our well. As soon as we put it in, they tied in. I didn't think it was very dangerous. It was just so different from that. It was truly like settling in a developed area, because that's what it was. And Nevis used to go out every weekend. He thought he was going to clear this land by himself with pickaxes and everything else. Finally, he said, this is not going to happen. This takes a bulldozer. So I think it was someone over in Paskerville, was it?
Paskerville.
Yep. Came in with a big bulldozer and bulldozed our property. And then
the guy who bulldozed the property was on 54th Avenue, St. Pete.
Anyway, it was very, very different. For those of you who don't know what it was like back then, it was it was major new development, and it took some courage to do it.
Oh,
snakes! Oh my goodness! Rattlesnakes, huge rattlesnakes, and coral snakes.
I'll tell you one better. You were on 128th south of Park Boulevard. My first house was on 128th, just a little north of Park Boulevard. The house that I bought was not finished. It was about 80% finished. It was a frame house. And the septic tank with two oil drums.
We had a well,
well water, and I also brought a 2-inch pipe. To get water, you had to pay for your meters. Mm-hmm. And I paid for 2 meters for neighbors so I could get water to my house, which was the next one up.
Dr. Lurie, Seminole High School was up and running big time in 1970 when the city was founded. Dr. Rose was the principal, Scott Rose, may he rest in peace. He was a powerhouse in the field of education. And Leslie Sampson,
yes.
Waters, now intern at Seminole High School, English education, thought I wanted to be an English education teacher, 1970. I decided that I wasn't quite prepared for high school students and went back and got my master's.
Yes.
Well,
My name is Greg Frangipane. I've been a resident since 64, so I've been around here a while. And one of you up there, and I can't remember who it was, mentioned Hollister's Hardware. Yeah, Hollister's Hardware. Me and my little buddy, you know, we were young, went up there and told Mr. Hollister we wanted to build a go-kart. And he showed us how to build it and everything else. The only thing he failed to do was to instruct us on how to build brakes. So we called this go-kart. This was not a slot car. This was a motorized go-kart with a lawnmower engine on it. And we took it down Seminole Hill. And we got to the bottom, and there was no stopping. So we just kept going, and we finally just crashed it into a ditch. But I want to tell you a story that involves my wife and Jesse Johnson. She worked at the Bank of Seminole, and she was in charge of getting Jesse Johnson's birthday cake. And that was a big deal at the bank, you know. That was like the national holiday of the year, you know. So she goes over to Grant's Bakery. Everybody remembers Grant's Bakery over there, right? She goes over to Grant's Bakery, and the lady hands her the cake with a big smile, that, you know, and it was on the house, and everybody was happy, except that the cake said, "Happy birthday, Jeffrey Johnson." So here they were, icing around, trying to make F's into S's and everything else. And they just put a lot of flowers on it. And my wife finally walked up there, her hands shaking, you know. Nobody said a word, you know. But he knew afterwards, and he used to bring my wife frangipani plants every beginning of every week. He would come in on Monday mornings and bring her a frangipani plant, and she hated the smell but never told him.
One other thing I just thought of, 113th Street, south of Park Boulevard, at one time was called Hinklehurst Road. I don't know why. I guess Mr. Hinklehurst lived there. 131st Street, that was Bond Road. He owned it.
Where's the First City Hall?
Pardon?
Could you stand up, please?
First City Hall.
First City Hall.
The first city hall, the first office was, the chamber was the office for the city when it got started, but the first city hall was down at the Gillingmore Shopping Center. That, they had a, that's where the meetings were held, and someone built a little podium, so, you know, it's a raised place for the city council to sit, and I don't know how long it was down there, but the city had court down there. Colin Mangum was the judge, and Bill Dunlap prosecuted cases down there. And Bill and I were city attorneys together for a while, and then he and I disagreed, and I said, "Bill, you can have it. I'm not going to disagree. You can't have two people working as city attorneys and one disagree with the other one." So. But Bill did a wonderful job as a lawyer. But that's where it first, how long it was there, I don't know, but it was in the Gillen Water Shopping Center.
Where was that?
The Gillen Water Shopping Center.
Bay Ridge. Seminole Boulevard.
Seminole Boulevard.
Just north of 86th
Avenue. South of First Home Bank in that strip center there. That's Gillen Water Shopping Center. It's really not. That's what it, those are the family that, that's the family that owns it, but it's not known as that. But that's where it was. So.
And eventually, City Hall was right here.
Right here
in this building.
Yeah.
Should
we go on?
Right here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, my family moved here in 1946, and we were second trailer in Bay Fines Trailer Park. We opened up 7 years ago next month. And after I got married, and we were expecting our first child, Seminole High School wasn't built yet. No. And we saw a home up here near where the high school is now, and we were looking into buying it. It's been and they didn't have any telephone service up there. So she didn't want to go to buy that house, so we backed out of the deal. No phone service.
Yeah. I just have a question. I wonder how many people here actually signed, put their signature down that they wanted to be a part of the city back in those days? Anyone here?
Probably Maryland.
Because I remember very well Holland Mann coming to our house and said, you want to be in the city? And we went, well, sure, why not? Put our name down and go. I just wondered if there were others that Holland visited.
Did you have the lines drawn out before you went out? I mean, I know you had to have an idea. You just don't throw something against the wall.
Well, this is what Glenn Van Trees did this. They, you know, had to go out and get the data. You didn't have spreadsheets and computer or anything, so you had to get the data and just go down counting, you know, who's going in or out, and that's how they came up with this.
You mentioned the ad valorem tax. That must have been a big deal back then.
It was.
And that was your deal maker.
That's
you promised
right.
Never to have an ad valorem.
Right.
You stood up on the platform. Never.
It's no new tax. It's still a big deal.
Right. No new tax. No new tax.
But it was the cigarette taxes that kind of started it.
Has there ever been another city created in Pinellas County since the city of Seminole?
Not in the state.
Not in Pinellas County. I don't think so.
So this is the last city that was created?
Pinellas County. Any other cities created in Pinellas County since Seminole?
Yes.
Dave gives you a hint. City of Seminole was the last city in the state formed by that method of assembling 1,000 people in favor. The legislature, after that, changed the rules and required both a meeting and legislative approval after that. And so we were the last city formed that way. And no other city was formed in Pinellas County since then.
We've got our Jimmy Vaughn, we've got them. One of the original handouts, you know, that tells the people, you knock on the door and give them this, and they read it. And they got their name, like you said. And the ones that were for a city, the story goes, they wrote their name down. The ones that you knocked on their door and they said, no, we don't want that. They wrote their name down and put it in file 13. But we have the original. We're going to put it out. We're going to bring it in there.
About 18,000.
12,19. Come a long way.
Yes. And you guys got 75% of the people at the time to show up at this meeting. Because we got 75% today.
And you did it with privacy. That's a word that you never hear anymore, privacy. How could you do it?
Yeah.
You know, you said that they were coming strong after you.
Yeah.
Okay? And the tax was the biggest incentive at coming out of the 50s, especially after the fall of the 50s and coming together in the 60s. You know, and you know they wanted that tax base. The only way you get a bigger tax is expand. And then you said you did it in privacy?
Yeah.
Well, knocking on doors and talking to people.
Yeah, and file 13, the ones who didn't want
to. Well, that's why it's shaped the way it is.
Does anybody have any other questions for these gentlemen?
That's good.
Well, gentlemen, thank you very, very much. And if everybody wants to get up and mingle, ask more questions, have a dessert, some punch, please feel free to.